Hello friends, a very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of Jekesha Classes. I am Professor Saurabh Bhatt. Now in July 2021, finally our CA final attempt has taken place and we have to analyze paper 7, that is Direct Tax Law and International Taxation. We will compare the questions that were asked in exam and look at how we had already covered these in our during the course of our study. So let's start. The first question, friends, as you are aware that now 30 marks are reserved in paper 7 for multiple choice questions. So the descriptive questions that are asked, part 2 of the paper, is comprising of 88 marks, out of which 70 marks have to be attempted by us. So in that, the first question, which earlier used to be asked for 16 marks, but now it is asked for 14 marks, invariably is based on PGBP chapter. So even in this attempt, the first question that they had asked was based on PGBP chapter, and what our institute normally does is that they mix and match out of past papers from various big questions certain adjustments. So you may have last 4 attempt papers, and out of that you will find that 2 or 3 adjustments out of one particular question they have picked up and created their own new question. So if we look at our textbook, friends, you will find that a very similar type of question was already covered by us. This was part of PGBP chapter, wherein all these different kind of adjustments were already taken by us. So same type, they'll mix and match provisions of section 35, some deductions out of section 36, some deductions out of section 37. Then they will tell us certain amounts are not actually paid, so you have to disallow it under section 43B. On certain payments, tax has not been withheld at source, so you will disallow 30% of the expenditure under section 40, clause A, subclause IA. Somewhat like that, they had asked in this attempt as well. So that is as far as question number 1 is concerned, 14 marks. Question number 2, part A, was based on assessment procedure chapter. This was directly based on a Supreme Court case law. This case law is Dalmia Powers case. It is already given in your module as well, that is study material, and we had picked it up in our textbook as well. So this is a case where an amalgamation had occurred on account of scheme sanctioned by Honorable Company Law Tribunal, and thereafter the assessee had furnished a revised return, and that revised return was beyond the time limit of section 139.5. So the question was whether such a revised return furnished beyond the time limit is valid in law, and Honorable Supreme Court had held that once NCLT has granted its blessings to the scheme of amalgamation, and thereafter based on NCLT's order the revised return has been furnished, then such a revised return has to be considered by the assessing officer. There is no need for taking any condonation from the Central Board of Direct Taxes. So exactly same question has been picked up by them and asked for a 4 marks in this examination. Now friends, in question number 2, part A, what the institute has done is they had given an alternative question. So question number 2, part A, either you solve this question of Dalmia Power, which is based on a case law. Alternatively, they had asked another question, and again that question is based on assessment procedure chapter itself. So question number 2, part A, had two alternatives. The student had to attempt either one, and that alternative question is based on the fact that the assessing officer during the course of assessment wants to change the status of the assessee. The assessee had furnished a return and the assessee claimed that it was a partnership firm, but the AO wants to change the status to AOP, whether that can be done. Now friends, you will find again that in our book the same question, in fact this was asked long back by the institute, a similar type of question, and same question has been again asked by the institute in this July 2021 attempt. In that question they had said that the assessee had furnished his return in the status of Hindu undivided family, and the assessee wants to change that status to that of an individual, whether that can be done by assessing officer. The answer is yes, provided the assessing officer has given proper reasons for doing so and he has provided an opportunity of being heard before such an action is taken by him. So that can be done by the assessing officer. This was asked in May 1995, and after that straight away they have asked this in July 2021 paper. So that is as far as question number 2 part A is concerned. If you look at question number 2 part B, friends, you will find question number 2 part B is directly a something that we have already done. This is in fact forming part of the basis of reassessment chapter. So question number 2 part B is on reassessment chapter, and it says that the assessee during the course of reassessment has sought reasons for reopening the assessment, and that has been overlooked by the AO under the pretext that it's a procedural matter. Now you are required to examine as a tax consultant whether that course of action of the assessing officer is valid. Answer is absolutely not. Providing reasons for reopening of assessment, in reassessment chapter we have learned this, that providing reasons for reopening of assessment forms the very basis of reassessment. And Supreme Court of India in the case of GK and drive shafts has held that if the assessing officer does not supply the reasons within a reasonable course of time, within a reasonable period of time, then the entire reassessment proceeding is bad in law. So this GK and drive shafts we have covered at various points of time, even in your study module it is given. So this question, again I would say, was like, if I use a cricketing metaphor, it was like a full toss. You had to hit this for a 6, although this was asked for 4 marks. Moving ahead, question number 2 part C, friends, was based on international taxation, and this is from the chapter of double taxation relief. I would say if one question that was slightly tricky in this particular attempt, that would be question number 2 part C. That is because this question actually is based on our understanding of elective paper international tax, but they asked this in paper 7. Why do I say that? Because they have in this question provided us with the salary earned by the assessee Mr. Ram, and they have told us that we need to calculate the taxable income of the assessee and the net tax payable by him. Now this question, friends, is based on rule number 115. Rule number 115, which the rule as such we have covered in paper 7, but the application of that is covered in elective paper international tax. Rule 115 tells us that whenever any income is earned in foreign currency, then how do we cover this, or convert this rather, into INR. So for that purpose, in respect of salary income, rule 115 tells us, we have covered this in paper 7, the rule as such, it tells us that for the purpose of conversion of salary, we have to take the rate of last day of the month immediately preceding the month in which salary is due or is paid in advance or is in arrears. So friends, in this question, if you notice, they have already provided us the rate of exchange as on last day of the immediately preceding month in which the tax has been paid or deducted. So all that I need to do is that I have to take the salary amount and multiply this by this particular rate, because that is the rate of last day of the preceding month in which the salary has become due or has been paid to the assessee. Once I multiply this, month-wise data is given to me, I will aggregate it in order to arrive at my total income. Now, the second part of this question tells us that you need to provide the foreign tax relief and compute the net tax payable by the assessee. Now, that's the tricky part in this question, because if we look at the India-US DTAA, then federal and state taxes are covered in the DTAA. So, we know that whenever any tax is covered in DTAA, it is called as bilateral relief. But whenever any tax is not covered under DTAA, then it is called as unilateral relief. So this was actually the case of Wipro Limited, wherein Honorable Karnataka High Court had held that social security taxes would be eligible for relief under section 91. Based on that, we need to solve this question. For the taxes covered under DTAA, we will apply rule 128 and compute headwise whatever tax relief is available to the assessee, and after that we will apply section 91 in order to compute the unilateral relief available to the assessee. After we deduct the relief available under section 90 and 91, the net amount that comes is the net tax liability of the assessee. They have also asked that what procedure the assessee needs to follow for the purpose of availing relief. The procedure is that the assessee must furnish his return on or before due date under section 139(1), and along with the return he has to furnish form number 67, in which he has to detail out as to how the relief has been computed. So that is, friends, as far as question number 2 part C is concerned. Moving ahead, friends, the next question, question number 3 part A, is asked on the chapter of alternate investment fund. In fact, for 8 marks, this is a very, very easy question that was asked by institute, because over here we already know the principle that in case of alternate investment fund also we follow the concept of pass-through status. Only the business income is taxable in the hands of the fund and all other incomes are passed through to the investors. Here I have also told you, friends, that prior to the amendment, prior to Finance No. 2 Act 2019, the losses were never passed through to the investors, but now that position is amended and now even the losses shall be passed through to the investors. So all that I need to do is this business income will become total income of the AIF and balance incomes, even including the losses, shall be passed through to the investor. Since they have told us that there are 20 investors who are each holding 5 units, I will accordingly proportionately allocate this amongst the 20 unit holders. Then they have also asked us that what would be the implication if only 80% of the income is distributed. There shall be no implication, because in case of AIF, we follow the concept of deemed credit. So even if AIF has not actually distributed its income, but it shall be presumed that on last day of the year, the balance income has already been distributed. So for 8 marks, I would say this is a very, very easy question. Moving ahead, the next question, that is question number 3 part B, exact cut copy paste from our book. Only one change that they have made, in fact, which makes the question easier, is same types of incomes are given over here. That is question number 19 in non-resident taxation chapter, page number 219. The only change that they have made is that here the assessee is a non-resident Indian, and in the question that is asked in exam, they have converted that into a non-resident German company. In fact, why do I say that makes the question easier is because if the assessee is a non-resident Indian, then we had to test that what would be the tax liability if the assessee opts for Chapter 12A and if the assessee does not opt for Chapter 12A. Whereas here, when it is a company, we need not check Chapter 12A, because Chapter 12A applies only for non-resident Indian. That's an individual. So when they make it into a company, the question becomes that much easier. This was asked for 6 marks, so this was a fairly easy question. Moving ahead, next question, friends, question number 4 part A has been asked from Charitable Trust chapter. Again, a fairly easy question, because we have already covered a very similar type of question in our classes, and that is question number 3 from our module, from our textbook, that is on page number 268 of part D of the book, Charitable Trust chapter. First of all, they have changed the name, of course. In our question, it was Gangaram Charitable Trust, and in the exam, they have made it Tulsi Foundations. Otherwise, the major part, 70% of the adjustments are the same. I would say only 2 adjustments which they have added over here. One is that certain expenditures have been incurred by the assessee in cash. If you remember, friends, I had told you during our discussions that generally for Charitable Trust chapter, section 11 and 12 is a complete code in itself. No other provisions of Income Tax Act applies, unless specifically through an amendment the government wants that certain other provisions of the Income Tax Act should apply to the Charitable Trust. So one of them is that if Charitable Trust does not withhold tax at source, then section 40AIA shall apply to a Charitable Trust. Similarly, if the assessee incurs, the Charitable Trust incurs any expenditure in violation of provisions of section 40 capital A subsection 3, that is incurring of expenditure otherwise than through banking channels exceeding 10,000 to a single person in a day, then section 40A(3) shall apply, and that much of expenditure shall not be considered as application of income. So that's about it. They have just added that one particular adjustment. Other things are exactly similar to Sir Gangaram Charitable Trust question, which we have already covered in our textbook. Moving ahead, question number 4 part B asked for 6 marks. This question is quite interesting. I'll tell you why. Because they have asked this exactly from a past paper, but one adjustment that they have added in this is actually picked up from elective paper. So those students who are doing elective paper international tax may be aware that exactly from elective paper one adjustment has been picked up and asked in this question. So this question is based on double taxation relief chapter, friends, and in that what institute has done, this was asked for 6 marks. What institute has done is, in our book, in fact, we have incorporated that question as Mr. Hashim Amla. Same question where, you know, you have paid municipal taxes outside India. So that does not matter. They have specifically stated that this municipal taxes paid outside India is not allowed as a deduction in that foreign country. And we had discussed that it doesn't matter because we are computing the total income under Income Tax Act. So whatever deductions are allowable while computing total income under Income Tax Act, those will be available to the assessee. But which is the adjustment that they have picked up from elective paper? This is this particular adjustment, that the assessee has earned royalty income of 15 lakhs from Canada. However, he has received only 12.5 lakhs during the year 2020-21 and balance is outstanding, and he follows the cash system of accounting for the purpose of offering royalty income to tax. So when you follow cash system of accounting, naturally only 12.5 lakhs have been offered to tax. So the adjustment that you need to understand is that when I have offered only part of my income to tax in India, only part of my foreign tax credit will be admissible in the current year, and as in when the balance part of income is offered to tax in a future year, the balance part of foreign tax credit will be available. In fact, in paper 7, we have discussed this. We have discussed this when we were talking about rule number 128, that is foreign tax credit. Here, if you look at the proviso, we have already discussed this, that in case foreign tax has been paid and you have offered the income to tax in more than 1 year, so you have spread the income across various years, then the foreign tax credit shall also be spread across those years in the same proportion. So if you look at this question, 15 lakhs is my royalty income which has been taxed in Canada at the rate of 15%, but my foreign tax credit will not be 15 lakhs multiplied by 15%, it will be 12.5 lakhs which I offer to tax in India multiplied by 15%. The balance 2.5 lakh rupees, as and when I offer to tax in a future year, proportionate foreign tax credit will be available. Apart from this one adjustment, the entire question is based on the concept that we have already covered in paper 7 as part of the question, the name of which is Mr. Hashim Amla. Moving ahead, question number 5, part A, is based on TDS chapter. When we were doing our course, I told you that TDS is one chapter on which always you can expect a question in examination. And the reason being that after you become a chartered accountant, one of the things that you have to deal on a daily basis is with regard to what tax has to be deducted at source when you are making payments or your clients are making payments. So this question also is no different. Typically, 4 scenarios are given to us out of which we have to recognize where TDS would be deductible, and whenever TDS is deductible, under which section and what would be the rate. In fact, our institute has not taken any effort in being creative, because if you notice the first adjustment, a notified infrastructure debt fund eligible for exemption under 1047 has paid interest. So same kind of question we have also covered. If you notice over here, the fourth adjustment, same type of question has been asked, just the figures have been changed here and there. Otherwise, the entire question is the same. So that is as far as question number 5 part A is concerned. Question number 5 part B is based on transfer pricing chapter, and over here if you notice, this is based on resale price method, wherein I am Paras Limited, I have purchased certain blankets from Associate Enterprise Saksham Limited at 2000 per unit, and later I have sold it at 2100 per unit. So that is a resale price method, exact cut, copy, paste. That is asked from our book. If you notice, question number 17 in transfer pricing chapter, Peter Parker Limited. The only difference is over here it was pens, over there they have made it blankets. Otherwise, cut, copy, paste, exactly the same question has been asked. They have given us the relationship to establish how it is an associate enterprise. That is of course based on the conditions given in section 92A. We need to identify that both parties are related, that is associated, and then apply the resale price method. So that is question number 5, part B. Next question, friends, is question number 6, part A, B and C. Question number 6, part A, is based on miscellaneous provision chapter that we have covered. This is based on section 179. When company goes into liquidation, what are the duties of liquidator? So basically he has to intimate the assessing officer whatever are the assets sold out of that. The tax dues have to be met. So that is based on section 179, where the company goes into liquidation, the obligation of liquidator starts. Question number 6, part B. Again, a loose ball. This is explain BEPS and what are its adverse effects. In fact, in BEPS chapter, the very second question, first question was how is BEPS arising, and second is that what are its adverse effects. So that is question number 2. We have already covered this in our book as well. The third part of the question is based on chapter application and interpretation of tax treaty. They are asking us what is the modes of eliminating, approaches for elimination of double taxation. What do you mean by juridical and economic double taxation? This we already know, that juridical double taxation is where same income is taxed in the hands of same assessee in two different jurisdictions, and economic double taxation, same income is taxed in two different hands in two different jurisdictions. What are the methods of eliminating this double taxation? We have learned this, that there is an exemption method and there is a tax credit method which is prescribed under law. Either of that can be followed for elimination of double taxation. And can the problems of economic double taxation be solved by the above approaches? Now that depends on the countries. I have already discussed this during the course, that in India we do not believe that economic double taxation is a double taxation in itself. The government of India only follows that juridical or jurisdictional double taxation is a form of double taxation. So if the countries are willing, then economic double taxation can also be avoided. One of the reason why economic double taxation in India is not believed to be a type of double taxation is because in India we do not have CFC regulations. CFC regulations, we have already learned that in BEPS Action Plan 3, but I have told you that CFC is not a concept introduced currently in our domestic tax law. So that was, friends, the last question, which was based on application and interpretation of tax treaty. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. I wish you all the best for future. Thank you so much.